hello, hello to all you ELO enthusiasts out there. And perhaps to all those people out there who wanted to learn a bit more about the number one most underrated band of the 70s. If this just happens to be you, then you've come to the right place. Or, maybe not. If you're hoping for an unbiased educational trip through the vast ELO history, please leave now and go to Wikipedia. Otherwise, sit back, get ready, and hold on tight for the complete history of Jeff Lynne, Roy Wood, and all that is ELO. Oh yes, did I mention I wanted to do this entire documentary in under 10 minutes? Let's go! Liverpool, the place where it all started. Well, sort of. Any fan of rock knows that this is the homeland of It was in 1960 when the Beatles first became a huge sensation. Then, 7 years later, in the British town of Birmingham, a young artist by the name of Jeffrey Lynne struggled to get a career off the ground. She had a birthday yesterday. After trying to make it big with numerous bands, Jeff Lynne and his friends came up with a band that finally seemed to work out. Isn't that an awesome name? Well, Jeff Lynne's grandma didn't think so. So, she came up with a name that topped them all. With this new, granny-approved band now on the move, it seemed that Jeff Lynne could finally be happy. He ended up recording 2 EPs chock-full of Beatle-esque pop tunes, both of which saw massive critical acclaim. Too bad they didn't make squat. But then came Roy Wood. Woke up one morning, half asleep. Roy Wood was the head member of the successful rock band The Move. Upon being invited into a successful rock band, Jeff Lynne left the idle race, taking all his creativity with him. However, it wasn't long before Jeff Lynne and Roy Wood came up with a brilliant idea. Roy, I have this idea. What if we picked up where the Beatles left off? It would be brilliant! And that's how ELO was born, kids. They had the dream, they had the music, and, well, they both looked a great deal like circus clowns. With drummer Bev Beaven, keyboardist Richard Tandy, and a swashbuckling crew of string-type musicians, ELO was bound to be a success. But their first album was not, so Roy Wood left the band. He decided to become a wizard instead. Anyways, with Roy Wood now out of the picture, Jeff Lynne was able to focus less on teamwork and more on making good music. And good music was exactly what he they made. Throughout the 70s, ELO became increasingly popular and successful with each album they made. They even added a jolly young singer by the name of Kelly Grobet. And in 1976, things only continued to get better. ELO released the massively successful A New World Record. The critics loved it, the people loved it, and heck, the people in their hometown were no longer embarrassed of them. Oh look, that Jeff Lynne fella's made the front page. We should start paying attention to him, yeah? From 1976 to 1978, ELO released 8 hit singles across 2 very successful albums, A New World Record and the double album, Out of the Blue. However, all good things must come to an end, and in 1979, ELO released The Unthinkable. That's right, a painfully cheesy video collection of disco-infused madness! Whatever inspired Jeff Lynne to do this, I have no idea. Now, don't get me wrong, the album Discovery was still very successful. It even spawned one of their most successful singles to date, Don't Bring Me Down. For Jeff Lynne, Mick Kaminsky, Richard Tandy, Kelly Grocut, and the rest of the ELO gang, life was good. But, you know, maybe Jeff Lynne was sick of his dignity. So they went and recorded for the Xanadu soundtrack. Ugh. I'm not even gonna touch up on this one.
Let's go down!
In 1981, after their album Time, Kelly the Grocut decided to split with the band to create an album of ABBA-inspired tunes? Some of the other members decided to split the band too. But can you blame them? Jeff Lynne's ego was getting bigger and bigger. And the bigger it got, the better it felt.
That's what she said.
Ha! Good one, Jeff Lynne. By 1983, Jeff Lynne was getting pretty tired of ELO in its entirety, but was bound to this bizarre recording contract which stated that he had to record at least two more albums with the band. So Jeff Lynne came up with a plan. That plan was to record a double album, Secret Messages. It was to be a wonderful 18-track double album that, just as the title suggested, was littered with secret messages. This was to poke fun at the enthusiasts who thought their earlier records contained satanic backward messages. Personally, I thought it could have been one of their best. But the record company thought it was too much, so they took the album and cut it in half, leaving some of the best songs out of it. Nicely done, Jet Records. Nicely done. So, with one more album to go, Jeff Lynne was getting pretty desperate. But by 1986, the deed was done. Balance of Power was a collection of little ditties that Jeff Lynne quickly slapped together. Now, the critics just panned this album. Personally, though, I kind of like it. I mean, it's not like Roy Wood was doing any better. Ugh. Do your ears a favor and stay away from Roy Wood in the 80s. After disbanding ELO, Jeff Lynne decided to start a new band with some poor, struggling musicians. This band was called the Traveling Wilburys. Or as most people know them, that band with Bob Dylan, George Harrison, Tom Petty, Roy Orbison, and that guy from ELO. Throughout the 90s, Jeff Lynne recorded albums for some major names, made his own solo album, and got in a major lawsuit with some old members of ELO. See, they wanted to recreate the band under the name ELO Part 2. Gah, what a creative name. Jeff Lynne was so upset by this Part 2 business that in 2001, he decided to release his own new ELO album, titled Zoom. But with Richard Tandy being the only other original member on the album, it just sounded more like a solo effort. After Zoom, Jeff Lynne stayed pretty quiet throughout the rest of the 2000s. Most ELO releases in the last 15 years have been compilation albums. Compilations such as Strange Magic, the Flashback Box Set, the Essential ELO, All Over the World, the Definitive Collection, and an OH MY GOODNESS THERE'S TOO MANY! Sorry about that. Like I was saying, I don't think any other group has more compilation albums than ELO. Fast forward to the summer of 2012 and we have a load of eager Jeff Lynne fans, like you and me. Jeff Lynne is set to release a couple new albums soon. But he keeps on making us wait. How much more time will it take for Jeff Lynne's new album to be released? Only time will tell.